Bob, I wanted to thank you for the honor and the invitation to be with you in this place tonight. Although it is slightly terrifying, it was truly an honor. Thank you. So a young schoolboy had to write an essay about geese. This is what he said. Geese is a low, heavy-set bird, which is mostly meat and feathers. His head is on one side, he sits on the other. Geese can't sing much because of the dampness of the moisture. He's got no between the toes, and he's got a little balloon in his stomach that keeps him from sinking. Some geese, when they get big, have curls on their tails. They're called ganders. Ganders don't have to sit and hatch, but they just sit and loaf and go swimming. If I was a goose, I would rather be a gander. So what in the world do geese have to do with installing your new priest in charge of the Bible? Bear with me. I don't think there are any direct references to geese in the Bible, but there are certainly direct references to geese-like behavior in the Bible. You see, geese are social creatures. They depend on each other to survive. Geese can fly further than eagles do, primarily because they work together as a group. There's a purpose for their V-shaped pattern of flight. They fly in a V formation because the flapping of the wings of one goose creates an uplift for the geese immediately following. Scientists have studied this fact and say that flying in this formation adds at least 71% greater flying range than if the geese tried to fly alone. When the wings of the goose in the front begin to tire, he or she drops to the back and the other geese take the lead position. Then the geese in the back can be honking their encouragement to those in the front to keep going. While we may like the image of an eagle soaring high, strong and mighty, fierce, appearing to be effortlessly riding the wind, we actually can get much further if we act as geese. So there are times for eagles, and Father Bob, on your days to be an eagle, I would say that is your Sabbath day. Your day to soar, to fly high, to be alone with God, to rest, and to come back restored and refreshed as the lead gander of this wonderful flock, or the correct term actually is gaggle, of geese. So if you listen closely to the reading of Ephesians, you heard the phrase, for building up the body of Christ. Those who are graced as apostles, prophets, evangelists, and yes, there are some of those in the Episcopal Church. Pastors, teachers, they are so gifted in order to build up God's people, to help God's people grow in spiritual knowledge, in unity. The church is composed of many individuals, all of whom have an important part to play in the healthy functioning of the body. As Paul says, joined together and knitted together by every ligament. Each part working properly promotes growth and building up of one another in love. Now, each part working properly is an important phrase. We don't think too much about ligaments until we injure one and our bodies quit functioning to their fullest and our mobility is limited. Then suddenly, that ligament is pretty important. Ligaments are individual parts, each serving a unique purpose, but essential to the functioning of the whole. Every goose in that V-shaped pattern matters. The leaders, the followers, the encouragers, and the caregivers. Caregivers, you might ask? Yes, even among the geese, there are caregivers. For if a goose gets sick or is wounded, a couple of them drop out of the flight pattern with the wounded goose and remain with it until it dies or is strong enough to fly again. Then they join their own group and fly away until they're able to catch up with the group that's gone ahead of them. If a goose gets the notion to try to fly solo like an eagle, it suddenly feels the drag and the resistance of trying to fly alone. It quickly gets back into the formation to take advantage of the lifting power of flying together with others. Geese have strong affections for those in their group. Unity is a must for them in order to get where they're going. And believe it or not, geese travel anywhere from 2,500 to 3,000 miles one way each year. Sometimes at the speed of 70 miles an hour if the wind is in the right place. But this would not be possible without unity. What does unity mean? According to dictionary.com, which has to be right, unity is a whole or totality combining all its parts into one. Unity does not mean being alike. It is a diversity of parts coming together as a whole. The definition as it relates to literature and art is my favorite. Unity is a relation of all the parts or elements of a work constituting a harmonious whole. And we know that harmony does not mean sameness. There would be no harmony if every voice in the choir was tenor. Harmony is the beautiful sound of many voices coming together in one song. As the psalmist said, it is a good and pleasant thing when the kindred live together in unity, in harmony. All the various parts contribute to the functioning and beauty of the whole. So tonight we are here to install your priest in charge, Father Robert Gross, who happens to know a thing or two about harmony, about many instruments and one band. Having been a band director for many years, you know about leading and facilitating groups of folks toward a common goal. The church is similar to a marching band in many ways. I'm sure you can make more comparisons than I, but when I dig back to my marching band days, I think, yes, there are those who desire to work hard, to do their best, and to play well with others. Then there's always that one or two that want to speak louder or play louder than anybody else, and you can't tone them down no matter what. Then you have that couple of voices that are so soft and quiet, and no matter how much you encourage them to play louder, they just can't do it. You have chosen this man to be your follower, to be your leader. So if he turns right, turn right with him. Don't take a wrong turn and end up left. Bob, you have experiences that equip you to lead these people, and God has called you to St. Stephen's, assigned you to be their shepherd, their band director, their lead gander. The scriptures you chose tonight offer great guidance for priests. God told Jeremiah, "Do not be afraid of them, I am with you. Do not be afraid of them, they look like a kind of nice group of folks, and God is with you." The road may get bumpy, sometimes the way may not be clear, but remember God's words, "I am with you, fear not." And just in case you happen to be among the clergy who think they have to do it all, read closely Paul's words. Your gift is to equip. Your gift is to equip the saints for the work of ministry. You are not called to do it all, to be all. You are called to prepare and assist these wonderful people in the work of Christ, to furnish them with knowledge and skills necessary to love God, love one another, and love those out there in the world. And you are not alone in this ministry. Jesus sent his disciples out in pairs, two by two, as we heard in the Gospel of Luke. We are not intended to do this work alone, fellow clergy. You have colleagues that you can consult and call on to celebrate with and hopefully not too often commiserate with. You have a wonderful bishop and a fabulous canon who are also on your team. So should a time arise when you feel alone, remember Jesus' initial sending was not solo, but teams. Reach out to those who are in this blessed work with you. Be steadfast in the lifting up your hands in prayer, so that should a time come when you feel like throwing your hands up, it will be to the high places and to praise God. Remember your Sabbath day and keep it holy. Get out there and soar like an eagle so that you can come back here to this wonderful gaggle of geese that is St. Stephen's Episcopal Church. And may God bless you and each and every one you are called to serve and equip.
Amen. Amen.